Now stand. That's our opening number this morning. New name written down in glory. You remember that day that you were saved, that the joy that flooded your soul, it was a new name written down in glory. It's good that you are here this morning. It's good that I am here this morning. I miss it when I'm not here, and I hope that you do too. Y'all look good. Sorry you have to look at me. Father, as we come to you at this time, we thank you for the joy that we feel knowing that we truly are in the Lamb's Book of Life. Would you watch over us today, give us joy in our worship, Father, and may our worship be dedicated wholly to you. And it's in your Son's precious name, Jesus. Amen. A new name in glory.
I was once a sinner, but I came from the sea from my Lord. This was freely given, and I found that he always keeps his word. There's an opening name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white robed angels tell the story. A sinner has come home. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven. Nevermore to run. I was humbly kneeling at the cross. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels tell the story, a sinner has come home. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. When my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, nevermore to run. In the book 'tis written, saved by grace, oh, the joy that came to my soul. Now I am forgiven, and I know by the blood I am made whole. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. The white-robed angels tell the story that a sinner has come home. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven.
Sometimes my eyes get crossed and I try to get between them and the screen back there to make sure I'm on the right verse, and I always get messed up. Praise the Lord. Something to laugh about this morning. I'll fly away.
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have grown, I Moses flown up, fly away. Joy shall never end. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
Amen. Amen. And if you're wondering where you're going when you fly away, it is sweet by and by.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar, for the Father is so dwelling place there in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirit shall sorrow no more, not a sigh for the blessings of rest. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet on that beautiful shore, to our bountiful Father above, we will offer a tribute of praise for the glorious gift of His love and the blessings that hallow our days. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
Amen. For our communion hymn this morning, At the Cross.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would He devote that sacred head for such a woman as I? At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for crimes that I have done He hung upon the tree? Amazing unknown and love beyond degree. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. But drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself to Thee, 'tis all that I can do. At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Jesus said, "Do this in remembrance of me." 1 Corinthians 11:24. The bread represents his body. The juice represents his blood. We remember his death for us, but maybe as much as we need to remember his death, we also need to remember him. We need photos of Jesus in our hearts to help us remember we are not alone in our need. And the Bible is full of pictures of Jesus. There's a photo of Jesus on a hillside teaching. He is wisdom. Another on a boat in a raging storm that suddenly grows calm when he speaks. He is power. There's a picture of Jesus with babies in his arms and toddlers on his knee. He is tenderness. Another of a crowd of thousands sustained with an unexpected meal from just one little lunch. He provides. There are dozens of photos of Jesus with people he healed, dozens more with people he forgave, like that wee little man Zacchaeus and the woman at the well. There's a photo of Jesus sitting on a donkey looking out at Jerusalem, weeping over people who refuse to repent. He is compassion. Of course, there are photos of Jesus on the cross and then his empty tomb. He is mercy, grace, and truth. In Genesis, there's a photo of Jesus with his foot on Satan's head, and in Revelations, as a conquering warrior king on a white horse. He is victory. What is your need right now? How does Jesus want you to remember him today? Ask the Holy Spirit to help you put the photo you need in a frame and place it on the table of your heart. Let's do what Jesus asked us to do. Let's remember him. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for this communion time. Thank you for sending Jesus down here. Thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice. The blood represents your broken body. The juice represents the blood that was shed for your sins. Please forgive us of our sins. And I hope that you know that we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's all be standing to honor God's word.
I'll be reading from Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father God, we just thank you for these words. We thank you for your omnipotence and your watch care over us. And Father, we ask your blessings on Brother Tim as he breaks open the word further this morning in this service. Go with us now that we may understand and believe. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. Glad you're here today. Beautiful day. Turn, if you will, to Philippians as we make our survey through the Bible. We've come to Philippians. We had opportunity this past week to be in Branson for a few days and went and saw the Shepherd of the Hills program. Many of you, I'm sure, have done that as well. I was surprised at the end of it when the cast came out to do their bow and their get their applause and all of that. I counted there was 18 people, and I thought there had to have been more than 18 people in this play. And I think there probably was. I think probably some of the ushers and different people had come down for certain scenes, but because right at the end they had responsibilities, that's my guess. But I also think that some of those people had more than one role. I think there were some good guys who were also bad guys who were also, you know, and some young ones that played old ones and vice versa and all of that. But as we come to Philippians today, I want to ask you what your part in this story is. Now, Philippians, the book, was written at a specific moment in history to a specific group of people in history, and they were real people. I say that, it sounds a little bit silly, but just to remind ourselves that it was moms and dads, husbands and wives, slaves and slave owners back in those days, that these were business owners, these were employees, these were farmers, whatever their role was, to use a simple phrase, they were real. They were dealing with the issues of life just like we do, maybe different issues. One of the great struggles, one of the great hardships in modern life, I did get a new phone this week. That's awful. What a humbling, unpleasant experience for which I should be thankful. Sure enough, we sat down at the table last night with Jesse. I said, could you please, and I had tried, Annette had tried, and I said, could you please do this? And I couldn't have counted to five, and he handed it back to me. But it's such a humiliating experience, such a frustrating experience. And I don't know what it was in their day and time, that round wheel or what it was that they were dealing with that was new technology, but they had real lives. They had real temptations. They had real frustrations. They were real people. Philippi, as you might guess, was named after somebody named Philip. That it was a real place. It existed in real history, as does the Bible. I don't mean to, please don't separate that. But these were real people, and Paul was a real person. Paul was a real person with aches and pains and concerns and burdens. And he is sitting in prison. And a man named a man from Philippi comes with a gift from this church, which Paul started. If you want to read the account of that, you go back to Acts chapter 16. I'm going to ask this again in Sunday school, but just off the top of your head, what are a couple of things that happened in Acts chapter 16? Things that you might think of. One of them, the vision of the man from Macedonia that asked Paul to go that way and to start the church. The other one that might pop into your mind, the Philippian jailer. And, you know, sometimes it's funny, isn't it, how sometimes you have these two pieces of information and they never quite connect. I think in the copier that's called collating, you know, that those two things just never get put together, that the Philippian jailer and the book of Philippians, that he was probably in this church by the time Paul wrote this letter, he and his family, that they were doing their jobs, living life. They had relationship. They knew each other's stories. They had friendship. The other one that you might think of, and I used to have a fine boxer female named Lydia. Lydia, the seller of purple, that lady that hosted a gathering of believers in that town. But again, just trying to get a feel for, to use that, the realness, the humanity, the history of what we're looking at. It was a Roman colony founded when Rome had conquered that area, renamed after Alexander the Great's dad, Philip of Macedon, Philippi. Real place, real time, real history. So again, what is your place in this story? And you might be tempted to say, you know, some stories you read and you identify with a certain character, some stories you read and they happened. It was history. But in the greater sense of this story, in the greater sense of the gospel, in the greater sense of the word of God, where do we fit in this picture? As the gospel was spreading, as the message of Jesus Christ, his incarnation, his humiliation, his death on the cross, his resurrection, his exaltation as he ascended back into heaven, where do we fit in this picture? This is not a book that you and I would read and say, oh, it's a story about some people a couple of thousand of years ago. Even though that's true, it's a letter that a man wrote to some specific people in a distant place. And yet somehow we are connected to this. Somehow we are involved in this. Somehow this is our story also. Paul begins Philippians by thanking them, first of all, for sending the gift, for thinking about him. And he wants to assure them as he sends this thank you letter back with the messenger that he's okay. Being in a Roman jail was no picnic. He was in a hardship. He had opportunity, though, to share the gospel with many of his captors, many of his jailers, as he had done when he was in Philippi. And he's trying to assure them that it's okay that he's in jail, that God has a plan, and that even though he, in his physical person, is in jail, the gospel is not locked up. The gospel is not contained. And so Paul is trying to tell them, and he'll tell that in that, you know, that I've learned the secret of contentment when he gets to the end of the book. Whatever circumstance I'm in, I've learned the secret. This is the book where he tells them that, you know, if I die, that's okay. And if I live, that's okay. He actually says, if I die, that's better for me. And if I go on living, that's better for you. But he recognizes his place in the story. He recognizes the real value of things. When we talk about heaven and then we talk about real life, like I've been doing, Paul is pointing out that that may not be the right terms. That what we're doing here may not be real life. That real life and real living, the life that is truly life, that Paul tells Timothy about later, that's heaven. In the presence of Jesus, that's reality. And he goes through, he's trying to explain to them his circumstance and the gospel. He's encouraging, and this has been a theme through almost all of the letters that we looked at, Paul has a real passion for unity. Those spiritual calories that are spent between believers bickering over petty things are wasted. And he's trying to help them. And there's a couple of ladies, it happens to be, in this circumstance, that he will deal with in, what, chapter 3 or chapter 4, where he'll say, hey, it's enough. Stop. Okay? You know, just keep the main thing the main thing. We don't have to all be robots. We don't all have to check in our personalities. We don't have to check in our opinions. But this thing about Jesus is so overarching and so overwhelming that it makes all the rest of that small. He talks about unity. He talks about humility. That's the part we're going to look at in chapter 2. The central part of Philippians. Everything builds up to, and then everything summarizes from, that section that Karen read for us in chapter 2. It's interesting. In my notes, I put the words wrote or quote, just as a reminder to me. We don't know for sure if Paul wrote this poem or possibly him, not that those things are always separate, but we don't know if Paul wrote it or if he quoted it. If it was already in existence and Paul grabbed it and used it, or perhaps he adapted it a little bit. I don't think there were copyright laws back then. I think that was totally on the up and up. I'm not sure. But he goes into this hymn, this poem, probably as good as any. Can you even say that about the Bible? I was in a meeting one time and they said, well, what's your favorite passage about the resurrection? And a wise preacher who was not me said, well, I actually think they're all pretty good. And I thought, that's probably the right answer. You know, to have a favorite scripture, all scriptures God breathed and used, you know, okay, this is pretty good. You know, John 3:16, this passage is worth committing to memory, to have in the written on your heart. It is the gospel. It is the story of Jesus. If we were going to ask the question, what's your part in this story, we would begin by saying, what's Jesus's part in this story? And Paul answers that here. I'm going to start in verse 5. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus. And then he goes through, who being in very nature God did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. And there's a wealth there. Jesus had position. Jesus had power. I believe this speaks to the pre-existence of Jesus. I believe that Jesus existed, that the Christ, the Son of God, existed prior to birth in Bethlehem and the giving of the name Jesus. I believe he's the doer of creation. I think Colossians backs that up and elsewhere. That Jesus is deity. He says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. I and the Father are one. He says to them, before Abraham was, I am. He makes a wealth of statements. Thomas in the upper room says, my Lord and my God, and Jesus does not pull back from that. This speaks to something that Jesus had that he was willing to let go of. Now that brings up the second question. So you're saying that he was God and then he let go of being God. And I don't feel that either. And I don't think the Bible supports that. But I think he let go of his position. I think he let go of his glory. There's always that question about the incarnation, and I heard it put as well the other day as I've ever heard it put. A preacher was telling a story to a group of kids, and he was trying to demonstrate that Jesus, though he was God, was also a man. And he said, so Jesus had to brush his teeth every day just like we do. And it's interesting. I would have never thought of this. A lot of people used pig bristles to brush their... I don't think Jesus probably did that as a Jewish person. They didn't eat a lot of sugar back then, so it's a little bit different as opposed to us. But anyway, just in the generic story, the preacher says Jesus was a man just like we are. He had to brush his teeth. And a bright kid raised his hand and said, could Jesus have gotten a cavity? And this preacher is thrown into this huge theological question in his mind, whether the body of Jesus could have suffered decay. Anyway, I found that humorous, only in the sense that this is difficult. In the situation, in the circumstance where David, in a different circumstance, uses that phrase that this is too lofty for me. And I don't mean to be able to reduce this. And I don't exactly know what Jesus knew when he was 12 and what Jesus was able and not able and how. But it says here that he let go of. It says in the next verse that he emptied himself. And yet we see him do miracles. And yet we see him speak truth. And yet we see him demonstrate his ability not to sin, an ability that none of us have. And so this question of the incarnation, that he was with God in the beginning, as it says elsewhere, that he did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself. To understand the part that Jesus plays in this story, that he came from somewhere, that he left something, and that he took upon himself something to become our Savior. Hebrew Messiah, Greek idea Christ, the sacrifice that was given on our behalf, the sinless one, he who knew no sin, who becomes sin for us. And there's a lot packed in here, but Paul is pointing them through this hymn to the main thing again. He says, therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. That Jesus, the doer of creation, the one who existed prior to creation, the one that it says that if we know him, we know the Father, that in likeness, in personality. You know, I'm going to ask that in Sunday school so you can think about the answer to that also. What would your opinion of God have been? What would our opinion of God have been if it hadn't been for Jesus? Now, we're not in that circumstance. I don't even know that we can hypothetically think through that. But it is in the coming of the person of Jesus that we learn a lot of what Cooper talked about, the tenderness and the compassion and the sympathies, the personality, what Jesus, what God is like and what God likes, that we find out what pleases him and how the person of Jesus changes our opinion about who God is. How God is. And so here you have that. You have Jesus in his humanity. You have Jesus in his humiliation, this death, even death on a cross. And there's so much, You know that scripture that says, cursed is anyone who hangs on a tree, who's hung upon a tree. The scripture tells us that Jesus became the curse for us through his death on the cross. There was this belief among Jewish people that the most humiliating, the most undignified, the worst thing you could do to a person was to kill them and not bury them. That public display of death was what we think it is also, just unfit, unacceptable. And so the idea that they would take a body and hang it publicly in display for death, it showed that that was a curse. It was undignified. It was the most humiliating, inhumane thing that you could do. You know, you think about this, and I don't have the answer to this. I give this to you to think about. We see them in the Gospels taking Jesus to the Romans, right? Why? Because they don't have the authority to kill him. Because they don't have the authority to give him a death sentence. But then you jump ahead to Acts chapter 7. They just pull out stones and kill Stephen. And so why is that? What they didn't have the authority to do was to crucify Jesus. What they didn't have the authority to do was to hang him up on a cross in public display of the curse and the undignified death. They didn't get in trouble for stoning somebody if they were quick about it. If they just got it done and got it disposed of, the Romans didn't care. But they wanted more than that. They wanted to publicly disgrace Jesus in order to refute what he said and who he claimed to be. And so they do that through Roman means, in keeping with the scriptures, what the scriptures foretold. But their motive was because that Jesus would be cursed. And then, of course, Paul captures that and says, as I've already mentioned, he became a curse for us. That the curse of sin is lifted from us. His death on the cross. But God doesn't leave it there. There is the resurrection. This same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead will raise us also. And there is resurrection, but that's not enough. After resurrection is exaltation. After the resurrection is the ascension, that he goes and that he serves even now at the right hand of the Father on our behalf. That even in heaven now, his agenda is serving, ministering to us. And so you have that exaltation. You come to that section where it says that every name will confess that Jesus is Lord. And it's not a question of if, it's a question of when. And it's a question of what the result will be when you do it. Whether it will be a praise or whether it will be to your own condemnation in confessing he really was Lord. When you read through this scripture and you think of the people who say, I don't need a savior. I didn't ask anybody to die for me. And yet we realize the sin, the rejection of God that is among us. As we come through this passage, of course Philippians is about joy. Of course there's passages about unity. Of course there is celebration. This is a church that Paul dearly loved. He doesn't deal with any major wrong teaching. He's celebrating. They were a Roman colony in a circumstance, in a setting that promoted power, that promoted ascending above other people, climbing the ladder so that people are under you. They lived in a culture of extreme patriotism. Philippi was a place of many retired military. It was a time of very aggressive emperor worship. And Paul comes in with this picture of Jesus. Not as the, you know, you could start there and say, well, he was this Jewish peasant that came along and got a big following. But instead, Paul starts elsewhere and says, no, he was exalted and he emptied himself of that glory and came to be the servant of all. and that the path to greatness, the path to exaltation, is through service, that it's through sacrifice. It is through the emptying of oneself. And he shows them in the later chapters of this book that that's your part of the story. That's our part of the story, is that we're to live out the story of Jesus. That whatever it is that we have or think we have, whatever it is that we use to glorify ourselves, that we might use to lift ourselves up in front of another person, that we might find satisfaction in to think that we're better than somebody else, or that we truly have, that somebody else doesn't have, and so we might think we're better than them because of that. That whatever it is that we might glorify in, that we might find satisfaction in, that we might find security in, that our part is like the part of Jesus. We're to let go of that. But we're to let go of it in the confidence that God will not forsake us or forget us. Because of what Jesus has done on the cross, we can let go. Because of what Jesus has done on the cross, we don't have to hang on to anything in this world. We can risk being the servant of all. We can risk our own humiliation. We can risk our own lowering. And opposite, in direct opposite of what the times would have, that they could allow themselves to be emptied of everything that this world has to offer in the confidence that God would bring them, that God would exalt them. Are you willing to let go of everything like Jesus did? Are you willing then in humility to become the servant of others, even in a time of disagreement, even in a time of difference of opinion, to be willing to say, you know what? It doesn't matter. The only thing that truly matters is that Jesus is Lord. The only thing that truly matters, as Galatians says, is the truth expressing itself in love for one another. From Jesus, from this hymn, from the book of Philippians, we learn what God truly is like and what God truly likes. God asks us to empty ourselves, to let go of those things in which we glory, so that we might become the servant of others, and that by humbling ourselves, as it says, he may lift us up if we humble ourselves in the sight of the Lord. So I want to encourage you today. That's what this book is about. Encouragement. That if you follow the path of Jesus, that God is consistent, God is faithful, and that you have every reason to rejoice. Let's stand. Father, we thank you for this good day. We thank you for this scripture, for the truth that is found in it. We thank you for our Savior Jesus, for the hope that we have in him. I pray today, Lord, that your Holy Spirit will make application of this truth to our hearts, that we might be reminded that so much of what we worry about, so much of what we cling on to, is just going to rot, rust, and fade. The things that truly matter, the treasures that are truly treasures, are the ones that are in heaven. We're thankful for the example of the Apostle Paul. We're thankful for the teaching that he gave to the church at Philippi. Lord, that we might find truth in it, that we might find our place in the story. We're thankful. We ask your Holy Spirit again to move in our hearts that your will might be done. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back.
Any other updates?
Jerry's sister Sue is in the hospital.
Sue Stagner is in the hospital. Any other announcements, stuff we mentioned? Lord willing, we'll be here Wednesday night. I want to encourage you to come and be a part of that. We open the door at 5:30. We usually eat around 6. Have a little Bible study, just time to get together midweek and encourage one another, and want to invite you to be a part of that. Any other announcements? Very much appreciate the hard work that was put in by a lot of different people for Men's Fellowship Monday night. It was a wonderful get-together. It was a wonderful meal. Very much appreciated. And there was another really great crew that came in yesterday, did a lot of work. Some of it you can see. If you do, fine. If you don't, fine. I'm not going to mention it. But the rest of it, you won't see. The cleaning out of the old basement and getting ready for the work that will begin in 2 weeks, shortly after Labor Day. So that project is coming up. Again, thank you to those who have been able to give to that already. We have our harvest offering coming up. But there was a great amount of work that was accomplished in these last few days, and the Lord knows. Thank you very much for all that you did. Yes?
There's some cucumbers and tomatoes in the entry, right? If anybody wants to take some
off. Very good. You can have my cucumbers. Yes? Benjamin?
No, I was just
eating. Would you ask the Lord's blessing on us as we go?
Most Lord, Lord God, come before you thankful. You've allowed us to gather together in this place. You have granted us the benediction of your fellowship with us. Lord God, we pray that you be ever mindful of these things that we've heard and these things that we've been taught. Lord God, indeed, give us a mind like Christ. Make us humble in all things. Lead us and guide us by your Holy Spirit, Lord, for indeed we know not the way of our own accord. But it is only that you bless them with your presence that we are able to follow. Lord God, we ask your hand of healing upon all those who are sick. We pray, Lord God, your hand of comfort upon those who are sick. Lord, we know that there are many who are unable to be here this morning, and we ask, Lord God, to bless them with your presence and your benediction upon them. Lord God, we pray that you would guide us and lead us and direct our paths. It is in that name which is above all other names, in the name of Jesus, we ask and pray these things.
There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. The white robed angels tell the story. A sinner has come home. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. And my sin for heaven, little sin. Heaven never more to roam. Amen.